is a presentation on an approach to pediatric white matter disorders. Now, not so often, or collectively quite often, we might come across such cases in which there is children present with neurological symptoms and there are extensive white matter changes. So this is exactly what we will be dealing with in this presentation. White matter disorders typically include a gamut of inborn error of metabolisms, because this is a disorder in which there is some problem with the metabolism in the brain because of some genetic makeup, and these are also called leukodystrophies. Sometimes they can also be acquired. MRI is extremely sensitive for detecting these signal abnormalities in the brain. However, because of the many of these leukodystrophies can have an overlap of these imaging findings, and also each leukodystrophy can have a very wide spectrum of the imaging findings, it may be difficult to reach a clinical diagnosis. And hence this lecture, which will help us to at least narrow down the differentials in a focused manner. In this presentation, we will first learn how to distinguish between normal and abnormal white matter in children, including how myelination develops. We will also then formulate an approach to these metabolic disorders, and also briefly touch upon the role of newer imaging techniques. I may not be able to cover the theory behind every disorder, but at least we will try to cover it in a case-based manner. So first of all, it's most important to learn how to recognize a normal MRI. The second image on each side, this is T2 and this is T1, is a normal myelinated adult brain, which we are all very used to seeing. In unmyelinated brain patients, the challenge is that this contrast is reversed, and because of this abnormal hyperintense signal in the white matter, we may mistake this hyperintense signal from the normally unmyelinated white matter from some abnormal metabolic disorders. So first we will study how myelination progresses. Myelination progresses in a very orderly and predictable manner. It is a dynamic process that starts during the intrauterine life and continues well after birth. And awareness of the changing patterns of this appearance on the brain MRI as a result of this myelination is essential for providing an accurate assessment of the normal myelination and identification of the disease processes. In a very simplified manner, we need to remember that myelination progresses from caudal to rostral, from posterior to anterior, and from the center to the periphery. And this is consistent with evolving neural functionality. There are some exceptions to this rule, of course. Myelination is first seen on T1 weighted images. In the term neonates, myelination is seen typically in the dorsal brainstem, in the ventrolateral nucleus of the thalamus, in the posterior limbs of the internal capsule, and in the perirolandic regions. By 1 month of age, this myelination becomes more robust and is also seen in the optic radiations in a more robust manner. By 4 months, myelination is seen in the anterior limbs of the internal capsule and also in the in the splenium of the corpus callosum. By 8 months, myelination has progressed now up to the subcortical white matter of the parietal, occipital, and to some extent it is also extending in the frontal lobe. So it progresses from posterior to anterior in this gradient. And by 12 months, myelination on T1 weighted images is for all practical purposes complete, and it almost looks like an adult brain. And there is hardly any change after 12 months. On T2 weighted images, myelination will progress a little more, it will lag behind the T1 weighted images, and at maybe around 8 to 10 months of age, because of this reversal in the signal, T2 hyperintense signal becoming T2 hypointense signal, there is blurring of the gray-white matter differentiation, and this is a normal physiological variant. Myelination progresses in the frontal and the temporal subcortical U fibers, and the temporal subcortical U fibers are the last parts of the brain in which myelination is seen. So in the earlier stages of life, we have to evaluate T1 weighted images, and after around 6 months to 1.5 years, myelination is evaluated on T2 weighted images. So this patient had come to us for evaluation. This was a 4-month-old child with West syndrome, and it was reported as vanishing white matter disorders somewhere else, because we are seeing this hyper intense signal in the subcortical white matter, and hence the diagnosis. But now we know that at 4 months, obviously the myelination in the subcortical U fibers on T2 weighted images will not be complete, and this is a normal physiological variant. And even later, even after 1.5 to 2 years of life, there will be some terminal zones of myelination that will persist, and that can persist well in up to maybe 8 to 10 years of life, or even later sometimes. So when we are talking about white matter disorders, we should distinguish between demyelinating disorders. There already has been a talk about them, in which there is destruction of intrinsically normal myelin, and we should distinguish them from dysmyelinating and hypomyelinating disorders. So when we are evaluating MRI in patients with suspected white matter disorders or leukodystrophies, there are 3 MRI discriminators that we have to consider. The first major MRI discriminator is whether this white matter is normally myelinated for this child's age or not. For this, we need to know the exact age of the patient, including whether the patient is term or preterm, because accordingly we will have to correct the age. Delayed myelination has to be distinguished from permanent hypomyelination versus some other abnormality within the white matter, and it can only be diagnosed in a child that is more than 1.5 years of age. So how do we diagnose deficient myelination? When the myelination is hypo to iso intense on T1 weighted images, and it has diffuse signal on T2 weighted images, basically the MRI is just like a MRI of a very young child. It is not age appropriate, but if you had seen the same thing in a younger child, you would have probably called it normal. Permanent hypomyelination can only be diagnosed when there is an unchanged pattern of deficient myelination on 2 MRIs that are performed at least more than 6 months apart in a child who is more than 1 year old. This is a very important definition. So here we have a 15-month-old child. This scan looks like there is diffuse hyperintensity in the white matter on T2 weighted images. It is bilaterally symmetric, and it would have probably been normal for a child maybe around 4 months of age or 3 months of age. But this, because we know that this child is 15 months, this is delayed myelination. And again, here we are having hypomyelination with diffuse ill-defined signal abnormality in the T2 weighted images versus dysmyelination in Krabbe's disease or Alexander's disease with a gradient. There will be no gradient in hypomyelination. So here we have another patient, a 6-month-old patient. By 6 months, there has to be some myelination, especially on T1 weighted images. We are seeing hardly any myelination. We are not even seeing much myelination in the dorsal brainstem or in the cerebellar hemispheres on T2 weighted images. White matter is diffusely hyperintense. So for a 6-month-old, there is delayed myelination in this patient. This is Pelizaeus-Merzbacher syndrome. Some of these hypomyelinating disorders can also have PNS involvement, so we can just read up about it later. Here we have another patient with diffuse hyperintensity in the white matter, hypomyelination, and there are some other associated findings. If we see the basal ganglia, these are hypoplastic, as well as the cerebellar hemispheres. And genetic testing was done, and this was found to have tube 4A mutation, and this is hypomyelination with atrophy of the basal ganglia and cerebellum. Then we have another patient with cerebellar hypoplasia with hypomyelination and hypodontia with hyperintense signal, and on clinical examination there was hypodontia, and also we are seeing the cerebellar atrophy, hypoplasia. Here we have another patient, 6-month-old with delayed milestones with diffuse hypomyelination. At 6 months, we can see on T2 weighted images there is diffuse hyperintense signal. At 23 months, we are seeing that there is some development of myelination. This is not permanent hypomyelination. And on T1 weighted images, the brain looks pretty good. Most of the myelin has developed. And there is some prominence of the Sylvian fissures, and there is a focal cavernoma in the right temporal lobe. So, I mean, that's just an incidental finding. And this delayed myelination, which progressed over time, was seen in this patient with MCT8 deficiency. Okay, so the first MRI discriminator was whether myelination is normal or abnormal. The second MRI discriminator is whether these clinical find, whether the MRI findings are confluent and bilaterally symmetrical versus multifocal and bilaterally asymmetric. Confluent bilaterally symmetrical signal abnormality is seen in metabolic disorders, and if it is patchy multifocal asymmetric signal abnormality, we will see it in other acquired disorders like tuberous sclerosis in this patient or EDEM, for example. So these are the other differentials. And we can also see whether there is predominantly white matter involvement or whether the gray matter is also involved. The third MRI discriminator is where these white matter findings are typically seen. They may be bilaterally symmetric, but where are they? They can be predominantly frontal in Alexander's, parieto-occipital in adrenoleukodystrophy, periventricular in MLD, subcortical in subcortical or diffuse cerebral in Canavans, or posterior fossa may also be involved. Or there might be deep white matter involvement, whether it can be the thalamus, brainstem, or whether there may not be brainstem involvement. GM2 gangliosidosis can have diffuse thalamic hypointensity and basal ganglia hyperintensity. Brainstem involvement and involvement of the corticospinal tracts is seen in MSUD. Subcortical U-fibers may be associated with or without macrocephaly, and some disorders can also involve both the gray matter as well as white matter with striatal involvement. There can be Leigh syndrome or other mitochondrial disorders. And globus pallidus involvement is seen in Canavans. Globus pallidus as well as thalamus involvement is seen in Canavans. Globus pallidus involvement is also seen in methylmalonic acidemia. Other spatial MRI characteristics also have to be considered, whether there are any cystic changes, whether there are any other gray matter findings, abnormal malformations of cortical development, abnormal sulcation, whether there is any associated calcification or bleed, or whether there is any spinal cord involvement. And we also have to remember that leukodystrophies are progressive and they will evolve over time. And in the final stage, in the end stages, most of them will resemble, will have diffuse atrophy and may not be able to distinguish between them. Also, there may be a wide spectrum of severity depending upon the degree of functional gene products. In infantile Krabbes, there might be different imaging findings from juvenile Krabbes. So we'll quickly go over a few cases. So this was the first child that we saw. This child was a 5-year-old girl with difficulty in walking, delayed development, and we first thought it was MLD, but aryl sulfatase was negative. And we also see diffuse rarefaction of the white matter on flare images. So this was vanishing white matter disease, which was confirmed. Then there is another patient, 3-year-old male patient with delayed development, regression and neuropathy with diffuse periventricular signal abnormality. And clinically, the differentials that were considered were MLD, INAD and mitochondrial disorders. But this was because of this typical periventricular involvement, this was MLD, which was confirmed. Here we have another patient with diffuse periventricular signal abnormality as well as abnormality in the brainstem and the upper spinal cord and the cerebellar hemispheres. We are seeing diffuse periventricular abnormality, which shows restricted diffusion and diffuse long segment spinal cord involvement. This was mitochondrial complex 1 deficiency. Another, this is a patient with typical peritrigonal signal abnormality and also involving the splenium of the corpus callosum. This was an 8-year-old boy with scholastic impairment. This is a very characteristic age as well as gender, because this is X-linked adrenoleukodystrophy, so much more likely to be seen in boys. X-linked adrenoleukodystrophy. Here we have another patient. This is a girl with delayed development and scholastic impairment. Again, we are seeing this peritrigonal signal abnormality in the same location, but we remember this is a girl, right? So this is Krabbe's, and we also have to calculate the lowest score in this. We can read up about it later, but the lowest score is important to be given in juvenile Krabbe's and adrenoleukodystrophy, both. Here we have another patient, another case. I will quickly go over the imaging findings. The Sylvian fissures are wide open. There is also signal abnormality seen in the dentate nuclei. So anyone wants to jump in with the diagnosis? Glutaric aciduria type 1. Great. Here we have another patient, difficulty in walking, delayed development, generalized hypotonia, and we are seeing many findings, polymicrogyria, diffuse white matter abnormalities. We are also seeing some periventricular cysts. Anyone wants to jump in with the diagnosis? This was Zellweger's, because this is associated with malformations of cortical development. Here we have another patient, similar imaging findings, 2-year-old male with delayed motor milestones. We are seeing diffuse polymicrogyria bilaterally, as well as periventricular signal abnormalities and dilatation of the ventricles. So the differential that was considered was Zellweger's, but because of the predominantly motor symptoms that the patient was having, and also this patient was having brainstem involvement as well as multiple tiny cerebellar cysts and Vermeer hypoplasia. See the dysmorphic brainstem on T1 sagittal also. Anyone will jump in with the diagnosis? This was Merosin positive congenital muscular dystrophy. So that not everything with white matter signal abnormality is a leukodystrophy. This is congenital muscular dystrophy. Here we have another patient with 1-year-old patient with delayed development, mostly motor, with significant white matter signal abnormalities in a bilaterally symmetric manner. This was Merosin negative type of congenital muscular dystrophy. Here the brainstem is normal, there are no cerebellar cysts. Okay, here is another patient. When we are seeing patients with white matter disorders, it's very important to ask for history of consanguinity. So this is a patient with consanguinity, 10-year-old child. We can see that this patient has undergone cataract surgery. The lenses are not seen in the eye, and we are seeing bilateral periventricular cysts. So this is oculocerebrorenal syndrome or Lewis syndrome. Another patient, the next patient, is a 6-year-old child with abnormally curly, kinky hair and sensory motor neuropathy on ENMG. And we are seeing diffuse white matter changes, we are seeing abnormality in the dentate nuclei, and spectroscopy shows non-specific increase in the choline to creatinine ratio and reduction in NA. We are seeing diffuse white matter changes also involving the corticospinal tracts. So this is giant axonal neuropathy. So next patient, 1-year-old child, diffuse abnormality in the basal ganglia as well as hypointense signal in the thalamus, Tay-Sachs syndrome, GM2 ganglioside-osis. Apart from the neurological symptoms, we also have to look for other history. Like for this patient is again having consanguinity and abnormal hairs, abnormal silvery hair. I don't know if it's projecting well on the screen, but it was seen very well in the patient. And we are seeing diffuse periventricular signal abnormality. And also if this patient had decreased vision, this was Griscelli syndrome with silvery hair. Another patient with abnormal thin, very fine brittle hair, and delayed development, 3-year-old male with phenylketonuria. Apart from the conventional imaging, diffusion-weighted imaging plays a role in leukodystrophy, especially when imaging is performed during an episode of clinical deterioration. And this may represent cytotoxic edema, which may be irreversible. And sometimes we have to remember that not everything that is restricted on diffusion is irreversible. Sometimes it can also be reversed because of myelin vacuolation. So here we have a 9-month-old child with drowsiness, respiratory distress. We are seeing signal abnormality in the brainstem with restricted diffusion. So the differential here is MSUD, but this turned out to be beta-ketothiolase deficiency. So in addition to diffusion, we will also do spectroscopy in most patients with metabolic disorders. While most of these metabolic disorders will have non-specific findings of increase in the choline to creatinine ratio and reduction in NA, some metabolic disorders are associated with specific characteristics like Canavan's or congenital creatinine deficiency or non-ketotic hyperglycinemia or MSUD. So here we have a patient with metachromatic leukodystrophy. This diagnosis may help us in this particular patient, especially if it is performed in a reproducible manner to maybe monitor the progressive increase in the choline to creatinine ratio or progressive reduction in the NA. But apart from that, this really does not add much to the diagnosis. I mean, we already know this patient is having a white matter disorder. In Leigh syndrome, this patient is having basal ganglia changes as well as a prominent lactate peak. So here we have another patient, a 4-year-old with neuroregression and diffuse white matter signal changes, including the basal ganglia, globus pallidus, and thalamus. And we are having a very prominent NAP, so peak. So Canavan's disease is one of the disorders in which spectroscopy helps in clinching the diagnosis. Here we have another patient, a 3-year-old male child with dryness and ichthyosis in the hands, spasticity, and delayed development. On MRI, we are seeing non-specific hyperintensity in the periventricular regions. Very difficult to make the diagnosis. But spectroscopy showed prominent lipid peaks, which confirmed the diagnosis of anybody? Prominent lipid peaks with ichthyosis and delayed development. This is Sjögren-Larsen syndrome. Then we have a 17-month-old patient with neuroregression. We are seeing diffuse white matter volume loss. White matter volume loss and diffuse signal abnormality in the white matter. However, there are no other specific findings on MRI. The CT, on SWI and on CT, there are tiny specks of calcification in the basal ganglia. So this confirms the diagnosis of Aicardi-Goutier syndrome. And we also see on serial MRI, there is progressive reduction in the white matter volume in Aicardi syndrome. So this Aicardi-Goutier syndrome falls under the classification of infant interferonopathies, which are characterized by these four findings of refractive inflammation, calcification, white matter abnormalities in the very young, which are progressive, and CNS lymphocytosis. So that brings me to the end of my lecture. When we are seeing any patient with white matter disorders and when we are suspecting leukodystrophies, first we have to confirm, is there any hypomyelination or is myelination is appropriate for age? Is the white matter abnormality diffuse and bilaterally symmetrical versus whether it is multifocal, patchy, and asymmetric? What is the distribution of the signal abnormalities? Is it frontal? Is it periventricular? Is it diffuse? Is it parieto-occipital? Is it subcortical? Is there any brainstem involvement or any posterior fossa involvement? So when we evaluate all this, this is available on the net. So you can just save this table, and when we evaluate all this, we can come on, and when we also look for other specific findings like cysts, calcification, malformations of cortical development, or spinal cord involvement, we may, with this focused pattern recognition approach, we may be able to narrow the differential diagnosis.